I'd like to call this June 17th Economic Development Meeting to order. First of all, I want to thank everybody on behalf of Borough Council for coming out this evening. I'm really happy to see a nice crowd of people here this evening, and I'm going to basically turn everything over to the head of the Economic Development, Mr. Pezza, who will be running this meeting, and then from there, however you want to format, you want to put in place, Bill, we'll just follow your lead.
Okay.
So I know your committee put a lot, first of all, I want to thank you for all the time. I know two nights in a row, you met till 11 o'clock at night, so I know you put a lot of time and effort into this plan, and again, I want to thank you on behalf of council and everybody from the borough. So I'll turn, I'm going to step down so I can watch this. Robin's probably going to move over to the side.
Just temporarily.
I'll turn the meeting over to you.
Robin, just take the placard with you, then it's, you know. Thank you, Mr. DiGiuseppe, and good evening. I want to thank the council for the opportunity that you've given us over the past year to do this work, and certainly for the opportunity tonight to be here. I know how much time it takes to be a council member, and you're out several nights a week, and this is another one, and we appreciate it. I also want to thank the public for its interest and support. If the attendance tonight is any indication of what we're feeling townwide, and I believe it is because of the feedback we get on the street, it's a very, very good sign. I also want to thank the committee for literally, I know it's an overused term, but for countless hours of work. I'd like to take a minute to introduce the committee members, most of whom are here, some are not. Lauren Ivanchenko, Angelo Catroci, Ron Walker, Julie Bowser, Amy Kazar, Joanna Schneider, Carl White, Susan Curletto, Donna McCluskey, Barbara Swanda from Landmark Towns, Ralph DiGiuseppe III, Amy McElvain, Mark Swift, and then we had four additions as our work went on and we called for volunteers and people stepped up. Jimmy Brayson, Justin Saxton, Deal Wright, and Vivian Zalesansky. The full report of this action plan contains over 61 action steps. Some are very narrow in scope, some are dramatic, some are minor. Some will spark debate, most will be immediately embraced. They are all in the booklet you'll receive later tonight. This presentation focuses on just 20 of them that we feel are the most significant and worthy of dialogue. I want to add that this plan is fluid. It is designed so that as some goals are met, others are added to the list. Hopefully, it will serve as a catalyst for an ongoing empowerment of citizens who want to get involved and want to help. The format we'll follow is, we'd like to present this plan without interruption. It'll take about 40 minutes. I ask that you jot down any questions or comments you may have. The second portion of the evening will be devoted to questions from the council. Following that, we'll invite the public to speak. We want to thank Lynn Bush and the Bucks County Planning Commission staff for their assistance with the PowerPoint and booklet. All of our work over the past year has been done with zero cost to the borough. So now I'd like to turn our attention to the screen, and I'll also say that some of our committee members are sitting in the audience, some are up here on the other side of the rail. As council asks questions later, I'll be able to deflect them to the people that I think are most capable of answering them. So with that...
Bill, there's some people standing. There's some
seats.
And there's a seat up here if anybody wants it.
Jay, if you guys want to
sit here.
Okay. Okay, so let's begin. There's our beloved Bristol Borough, an aerial shot, which also shows our greatest asset, in our view, the Delaware River. Our goal from the beginning was to establish Bristol Borough as a great place to visit, live, or invest, and you've heard that term several times. First, we want to make this point very clear. The borough leadership has done a tremendous job in rebuilding the tired old bones of the town's infrastructure, paving the way for our next economic growth cycle. We have paved streets. We have signalization that is modern and attractive. We have a maintenance facility. We have up-to-date, state-of-the-art, really, service equipment that provides service to our residents in a not only an economical, cost-effective, but labor-effective way. So you guys have done a great job, and nothing we're saying tonight should be construed as implying that you've dropped the ball in any way. What we're saying is, you can't do it all. There's too much to be done, and so we're here to offer our assistance, and as I said, to empower our residents to get involved. Given the large size of the proposed projects we're going to be talking about, we envision multiple action plans being launched simultaneously and managed by volunteer committees. So we're going to talk about 20 action plans tonight, or 20 action items tonight. They don't have to exist in a chronological way. They can be done, they can be launched in a simultaneous way. Now, change is never easy or without significant internal or external challenges. Not everyone is going to agree with everything we say, but things that are worth doing are sometimes difficult. And I think you'll see as we go through this that there's some actions that we simply have to take. The plan's success is dependent upon the support and cooperation of elected and appointed officials, business leaders, clergymen, educators, all resident stakeholders. We all need to get behind a plan to move Bristol forward from the private sector point of view. Over the past 18 months, borough residents have repeatedly demonstrated a strong desire to move forward through their participation in meetings and early action activities. As I've said a couple of times, we filled the Bristol Riverside Theater twice with 300 people to come to talk about this topic. The support we've had for programs that we've promoted, like the Taste of Two Cities and the Restaurant Spotlights, have been extremely successful. We want to build on that momentum and continue to give people things to do. Our plan has 10 pillars, 10 foundations, and I'm going to go through each of them quickly because we're going to expand on each one of them as we go along. The first pillar is that we want to make it clear that our hope is to revitalize all borough neighborhoods. This is not a plan devoted to or focused on a particular section of town. It is something for everyone, vitally important. Second, and very, very important, we want to create financial tools and incentives to support investment, home purchase, and rehabilitation. What are there, 70? The number varies, but apparently there's about 70 homes for sale in Bristol Borough right now. We think we can do things to spur home purchases, and we're going to talk about those financial tools. Pillar number three is the business district, the idea of creating a vibrant business district and a broader business community. We'll be focusing on that tonight. Enforcement. Borough codes, laws, regulations, we believe they need to be revisited, and we need to have a dialogue about them, and we'll talk about them. Number five, historic resources, protection of our historic fabric and character. We're going to be talking about making sure that we all understand that historic preservation has an economic development component to it. It helps communities. It's a treasure. It's something we can build upon, and that idea of visit, live, and invest can be directly linked to historic preservation. The arts and culture. Supporting the arts and culture to fuel economic development and improve the quality of life. A lot of that overlaps, of course, with the idea of historic preservation. A strong business base. So this goes beyond just talking about Mill Street or the Central Business District. We're talking about expanding the business base throughout town and the surrounding area, and we'll visit that. Parking and congestion, self-explanatory. Number nine is one that I think is vitally important, because for all the things we're going to be talking about tonight, if we don't get community involvement, if we don't get volunteers, if we don't have people step forward to say, I want to play a role, I don't think we can implement this plan. So we're talking about recruiting and organizing volunteers and facilitating communication between government, residents, and community groups. Number 10 deals with the schools. The Bristol Borough School District as it affects economic growth of the borough. We'll visit that briefly. Okay, so now we're going to take each pillar and zero in on it, okay? So again, the first one, rebuilding neighborhoods and creating financial tools and incentives. I'm going to tell you some things you already know, because I think it's important that we just be reminded of them. More than 4 in 10 of the borough's homes are occupied by renters. Some poorly maintained facades and remodeling efforts disrupt the aesthetics, the character, and the beauty of the streetscapes. And we'll talk about what we can do about that aesthetic piece. This is a map of Bristol Borough, and what we've done, just for the sake of communication, this has no impact on zoning, no zoning implications whatsoever, but we've taken the town and we've tried to divide it into five logical neighborhoods, if you will, or communities. Starting, going clockwise, the very top at 12 o'clock is what we'll call the North Side community. On the right, the Harriman section. On the bottom, Old Town section. At 3 o'clock, or is that 9 o'clock? Let's see, is the Gateway. And then finally, in the center is the Mill Industrial section of town. Again, no implications except for us to be able to communicate with each other. This next map is pretty interesting, and it's not always very encouraging. What you're seeing is each of those white boxes represents a federal census district. And the federal government gathers census data and does a lot of things with it. And what you're seeing that is a mustard color on the screen are those census districts that have 40% rental properties. So in the areas that are that color, the darkened color, 40% of the housing units in those spots are rental. Those that are outlined in red indicate that in those particular census tracts, there are at least four vacant rental units or housing units. I'm actually not sure which, but there's four vacancies in those particular census blocks. Okay, so for pillar one, let's talk about some action steps. These are the things we'd like to empower people to do and ask people to run with, of course, with the blessing of council and reporting back to council. First, we want to make use of existing first-time home buyer programs. Seated in front of me is Joanna Snyder. She is the director of the National Penn Bank on Ratcliffe Street. And hopefully later on we can get her to briefly explain that there is a first-time home buyer program that could benefit residents of Bristol Borough. And it has teeth to it. So we'll want to talk about that. Next, and this is a biggie, you know, not all of these action steps are equal in importance or equal in difficulty. We think this one is pretty important. And I want to say it carefully because I don't want it to be misunderstood. We're talking about deferring additional tax assessments for reconstruction or improvements to non-delinquent owner-occupied houses. So let me explain what that means. If you know, quite often, people are reluctant to make an improvement to their home, to put an addition on their home or whatever it might be, because they fear that they're going to get reassessed and their taxes are going to go up. And it's a legitimate concern. But it also is an impediment to economic development. What we're suggesting is that, and this would take the cooperation of the borough, the school district, and the county, what we're suggesting is that when you do that, when you make that kind of renovation that would normally result in a tax increase, that tax increase would be deferred for years down the road. It would only be eligible for improvements to non-delinquent, which means people are already current on their taxes, current on their they don't have citations against them, no outstanding liens, and it would have to be an owner-occupied home. Now, don't think of this as a loss of revenue, because if the people don't do the renovations, you don't get the revenue anyway. This is an investment in the future. Encourage them to do the renovations and perhaps collect revenue down the road. And again, it would take the cooperation of the borough, the school district, and the county, but we think it's doable. And this is another what we think has some teeth to it and can be exciting. Formulate a for-profit group to purchase housing that qualifies for federal rehabilitation credit. So what we're saying is a bunch of private citizens would meet and agree to pool their resources, and they would identify houses that qualify for federal rehabilitation credit. It's a tax credit. They would purchase the home, they would rehab it, maybe in some cases they would convert it from a multi-unit to fewer units. They would rehab the house, they would hold it for the amount of time it has to be held under the law, and then they would resell it for an owner-occupied purpose. The result is the original investors will win because they'll make money on it, and that this is America, that's what we want people to do. The borough will win because it'll have a facelift on a particular house, and we'll get a homeowner moving into a nice place. So that's another recommendation. I think I already touched on this in converting multi-unit housing to single-family dwellings. We also want to make sure that Bristol has a reputation of being user-friendly. We want Bristol Borough to be open for business. We're not going to roll over for people, but at the same time, we want to revisit the process whereby all developers, builders, property owners find a predictable, easy-to-navigate, timely permit approval process. So from the time someone shows up and says, here's a project I'd like to do and I want a permit, from that time until the time the person finally receives the final UNO and says, good luck, here you go, you can occupy the building, we want to revisit that process. Now, to the borough's credit, first of all, the borough thinks it already does a good job with this, and perhaps it does. But it doesn't hurt to take a look at it, and to the borough's credit, say, sure, let's take a look. And if there's a way we can improve it, if there's a punch list we can provide that improves upon the punch list we have, let's do it. So that is another proposal. What am I doing here, Matt? Okay. Our third pillar, rebuilding and creating a vibrant business district and business community. Retail sales make up most of what we do in the borough, and I'm going to tell you something else that you already know. Okay, let's talk about Mill Street. Mill Street currently has approximately a 20% vacancy rate. It also has no retail anchor to speak of, no big store that would draw people, and a predominance of offices and personal service businesses. So in short, our Main Street is not living up to its potential. So what are we going to do about it? Well, not everything is easy. What we're proposing, and I think the borough is already embracing this, is that we need to assemble or attempt to assemble all Mill Street property owners and shopkeepers to review owner-merchant responsibilities. A lot of what we do has to be based upon voluntary compliance. We need to change the climate of the street. I want to make sure I add this before I forget. I attended a Mill Street Business Owners Association meeting about a month ago and was very pleased with what I saw. There were 25 people seated around the table. They were energized. They were being positive. They were working on things. And I'm happy to see that. We've got some really good people trying to do good things. The task is too big. We need more teeth. We need to change the climate so that peer pressure encourages those businesses that are not doing a job in maintaining their property and cleanliness and facelifting to try to do that. And it's going to be a two-pronged approach. We assemble everyone on Mill Street. We try to get them to come. And this is property owners and merchants. And we talk about owner-merchant responsibilities. The next step, a little more teeth to it, we assess repair work to bring all properties on Mill Street up to code. That we actually walk down, but people qualified to do so, walk down the street and look at every building and make a list of what do these buildings need to be brought up to code. We can do it in layers. We would start with the facades and we can work our way to the insides and whatever, okay? And then we notify people of what they need to do and we provide an amnesty period for completion. We're not looking to cave anybody's head in. We're not looking to fine people. We'd rather have money go toward renovations than to fines. So we try to do it with the carrot. We try to do it by appealing to civic responsibility. And if that doesn't work, of course, if they're in violation of the code, then you take the next step of code enforcement. Listen, you talk to the same people I do. Bristol Borough is not happy with the current state of Mill Street, because they know what it can be, they know what it once was, and what it should be in the future we're going to have to sit down and talk about. But it needs a facelift. Once we do that, we're not picking on Mill Street, we just need, we can only do so much at a time, and once we do that, once we complete that process, we want to repeat it for the same actions for the balance of other retail and service operations within the borough. We'll go elsewhere. Okay. We want to offer incentives to anchor retail operations to relocate to Mill Street. We want to try to attract, a couple anchor stores that would come. You have a gap on, everybody talks about the gap in Newtown. I don't know what exactly we will reach out to, but we certainly need to try to provide some incentives to make that happen. We also, and this might be a little, this may raise a couple of eyebrows, don't get too excited about it, but there's a couple suggestions regarding the Mill Street parking lot. You know, it's riverfront property. We have brought several land developers, people who, you know, we brought Mayor O'Malley here, we brought the gentleman, the Main Street consultant from Hatboro here. It seems like, our representative from Landmark Towns, seems like everyone who walks down the Mill Street parking lot looks at the back of the Mill Street buildings and says, wow, you've got buildings here that face the river, they face the nature preserve, they face ample parking. There may be things we can do on the rear of the properties that would really enhance the area. So one option is to sell a small piece for the purposes of a restaurant or whatever. We know that it's a floodplain. Restaurants along waterfronts are often on stilts. Might be a nice idea, but if that's not working, then the second part about doing something, exploring the development of the rear parts of Mill Street because of the assets that they have built in. The last thing about Mill Street is we need to address parking, alternative parking, loading zone options, whatever for Mill Street. We know, we've heard it for years, merchants park in front of their buildings, they feed the meter all day, and customers can't park. And they're, consequently, they get frustrated and tend not to use the street as much as they would. In addition, we have senior citizens being dropped off at doctor's offices. It's hard for them to navigate in and out. And then we have trucks, loading zones, trying to drop off supplies and foodstuffs or whatever. You put that all together and it's difficult. So we thought it's time that we sit down and take a long, hard look at parking on Mill Street and see what answers we can come up with. Number four. Enforcement of Bristol Borough laws, regulations, ordinances, and codes. No one likes to be told what to do. No one likes to hear that they're out of compliance with something. But the fact is, we have laws for a reason. The enforcement of borough regulations provides citizens and visitors with a safe environment and a high quality of life. Bristol needs to renewed effort to uniformly apply its ordinances. And we're talking about motor vehicles, whether we're talking about speeding, whether we're talking about parking, we're talking about abandoned cars, curfews, parks, public intoxication, noise, littering, sleeping, panhandling, whatever it is. Let's just sit back and take a look at the ordinances we have. This is what raising the bar is about. It's about saying we have higher expectations for ourselves and for others. How many times do we hear somebody say, you know, you never get away with this in Newtown or in New Hope or in Yardley or whatever. And this is not a knock on anyone. It's not a knock on our police. It's not a knock on our code enforcement people. It's simply saying, you know what, we need to rejuvenate our efforts. Let's sit down and visit these things and ask ourselves if we can do a better job and how can we do that. Sometimes there's a difference between working hard and working smart. We know we're working hard. Let's see if there's a smarter way to do it. Another more specific or narrow focus about code enforcement, we have a historical and architectural review board, and they make decisions when people appear before them and people are given direction as to what they're supposed to do as they move forward, and there's a belief that that doesn't always happen, that once they leave there, they don't always conform to the regulations or requirements that were put forth to them, and so we need to revisit that. Revisit the process and make sure that we're enforcing it with penalties for non-compliance. Historic preservation. Once you lose a historic architectural treasure, you don't get it back. So it's very important. Pillar five, protecting the historic fabric and character of Bristol Borough. We said earlier, this has to be a town-wide effort. We want to do something for all neighborhoods, okay? And what you're looking at there, Bristol Borough has four historic districts. And top left is a picture of the Grundy Museum, and that is in the center of the original historic district, the Bristol Borough Historic District. Top right is a scene from Harriman, and it is the Harriman Historic District. Lower right-hand corner is the Jefferson Land Association. You know, some people might just look at that and say, okay, so there's a bunch of row homes on Jefferson Avenue. The fact is, that Jefferson Avenue stretch and some of the homes on Mansion Street and Beaver Street, they are actually beautiful homes, and those property owners who have taken the time to restore them, to respect their architectural integrity, to use materials that are conducive to the aesthetics that the street can have beautiful properties. And if we can just get neighbors to realize that if that becomes contagious, those property values are going to rise dramatically. And then in the lower left-hand corner is the Grundy Mill, which is indicative of the industrial center of town, which is a historic district in itself. Industrial reconversion is a very important aspect of economic development, and we are ripe for that. And we've already have a couple wonderful examples in town of that already happening. So we want to reaffirm the borough's responsibility to meet the PHMC requirements for historic districts. You don't just get to be a historic district. You have to, it's a rigorous application process. The state has strict standards. Once it gives you that historic designation, you have to comply with their requirements. So we want to revisit and reaffirm the borough's responsibility to comply with all PHMC requirements for historic districts. We also want to seek design advice and grant opportunities. While I'm on the subject of grant opportunities, almost everything we propose in this plan is revenue neutral. We know the borough doesn't have a lot of money to spend, and we're not here tonight asking you to spend money, although there will be a couple times when we will. But there's grant money out there for signage, for interpretive signage, regulatory signage, points of interest signage. You go to the communities that have gotten their act together in that regard, and it's pretty. Your signage can be sign pollution, and there's grant money out there. Landmark Towns has been cooperative in this. We think it's time to really pursue that, and I know the borough has already done some things in that regard to lay the groundwork. This next one is very important. They're all important, but this next one, because we kind of scratch our heads over this one. Bristol Borough used to have a shade tree commission. And it was appointed by council and had very specific responsibilities. First of all, you were not permitted to take a tree down in town unless it was diseased or dangerous. Secondly, if you did take a tree down, you had to replace it. And sometimes the borough, at different times in our history, the borough paid for that replacement or it didn't. All right. And when you're replacing it, you were to select from a recommended list of trees that are conducive to the neighborhood aesthetically and also can live in harmony with our sewer pipes and our water pipes and our telephone lines. So we got away from that. And I have a report in my packet right here. There's all kinds of stuff available that says there's no doubt that trees add to the value, and realtors will tell you this, trees add to the value of a neighborhood, unless you have a tree that's ready to fall down. So our recommendation is that we systemically address the maintenance and replacement of public trees and plantings. Support for arts and culture to fuel economic development. In addition to the obvious quality of life benefits provided by institutions that support culture and the arts, there's also a ripple effect on job creation and economic stimulus. People work at the Bristol Riverside Theater. People work at the restaurants that feed those theater goers. It provides jobs. Our suggestion is we want to establish a theater district and delineate it with signage and special lighting. When Mayor Malley from Collingswood came to Bristol and he was talking about their success story, and somebody said, well, you have a theater district. How did you get it? He said, we created it. We just woke up one day and said, we have a theater. They only have one. We have a theater. It's a nice thing. It's a nice asset for the town. Let's surround it with what we call a theater district. And we're recommending we do the same thing. If you've driven down the Avenue of the Arts in Philadelphia on South Broad Street, you'll see that the trees are lit with those small light bulbs, and they call it their theater district, and they have signage, banners on their lights. And we think we can do that. We think it would make it special. And when a realtor is trying to sell a house, the realtor can say, this is adjacent to the theater district or whatever, and that stuff helps too. We also want to establish an arts and culture advocacy committee to advocate for local support of the arts and culture. We have the Grundy Museum. We have the Grundy Library, state-of-the-art library that does many artistic cultural things. We have the Artists of Bristol group, which is growing and is very successful. And we have the Bristol Riverside Theater. Let's put them together and let them speak. When it works, let them speak with one voice to advocate in support of the arts and culture in Bristol Borough. And I think that's redundant, I'll go on. We also want to reestablish walking tours throughout the borough. Donna McCluskey's here tonight, and I don't want to preempt what she's going to do, but if we have time later, she and the Grundy Museum have put together a really neat application for an iPhone where, and it's already, I think it's finished, it's ready to be rolled out, where you can get your iPhone and stand at a particular spot. Let's say you're standing in front of the Columbus Monument. Click on your spot, and it'll tell you about the Columbus Monument, and then you walk along, it'll tell you about the Irish Monument. You walk through the historic districts, it tells you what houses you're seeing and why the architecture is significant. It's a cool thing, and it's the kind of thing that visitors coming to town would like to see. And we can add to that with garden tours, ghost tours, historic buildings, monuments, statues, and whatnot. This is a map that would delineate the historic, the theater district that we're proposing. And basically, it runs from the Harriet Tubman Monument at the riverfront all the way up to include the 1 and 200 blocks of Radcliffe, and it also includes the block that runs the 100 block of Radcliffe, Market, Cedar, and Mill. And we'll talk about that in more detail. All right, this next one is one that really needs to be treated carefully. The Bristol Business Association has been primarily focused on retail activity and has been unable over the years to attract more than 15% of the 500 commercial uses in town. And again, this is not an indictment of anyone. I think we have people there that are working very hard, but it's a fact, okay? And the proposal is that we establish a new comprehensive business association with a broad mandate to stir economic development and business of the borough at large, as well as the Mill Street Business District. So we would see the Mill Street Business District as a subgroup or a subcommittee of a larger group. That group can continue to pursue its narrow focus as it should. At the same time, we invite everyone to join. Fred Baumgarten couldn't be here tonight. He has a medical issue. He does a fabulous job with the Grundy Complex. He's very interested in getting involved in a bigger, broader, stronger business association that can speak with one voice. Imagine if we can recruit 300 of the 500 businesses in town. We need to convince doctors, lawyers, realtors, hairdressers, people that you don't normally think of as retail. We need to convince them that they're running a business in town, and that anything that elevates Bristol Borough elevates their business. And we think we can do that. It's going to take a lot of effort. It's going to take a lot of shoulder tapping and personal contact. But we think the end result is cross-marketing, having the funds to market in a bigger scale, and we can do good things. We also want to become a municipal partner with the Bucks County Industrial Development Authority. I'm proud to say, and even if it's not totally true, Lynn, I think it is, that Bristol Borough was the first community to latch on to Commissioner Lockery's mission of making economic development his goal for Bucks County. And she's nodding her head yes, so I like that. And we got on that, and we've utilized the services of the Bucks County Planning Commission, and we think we've gotten some support for grants, such as the boat grant was helpful in that regard. They're talking about a proposed initiative to invest $18 million in loan programs. We want to get in on the ground floor on that. And we're not talking about lending money to Bristol Borough. We're talking about lending money to private enterprises who want to do things in Bristol Borough. So the Bucks County Industrial Development Authority is a very important entity, and we want to make sure we lock arms with them. And we think we've already demonstrated somewhat of a track record. I think the people in the county should know that we mean business, that we do with this effort tonight, that we're trying. And we would be a good risk. Okay, parking. We know that parking is difficult. Depending on where you live, parking can be very difficult. The lack of parking affects the sale of homes, the quality of life, and inhibits economic growth. We need a parking study. There's going to be a lot of stuff on the slide, but basically it means, let me go back here. Oh. It's a very active mouse. Oh, didn't want to do that either. Okay, well, we'll read all three. Let's start with the top bullet. We need a parking study, and there's grants available for such a study. We need to take an inventory of how much parking do we have, how many cars do we have, how can we best do this, what can we do? We can't just sit back and say, gee, it's a shame people can't park, because it is a quality of life issue, and it's an economic development issue. We also, at the same time, want to support walking and biking connectivity throughout the borough. If you look at the towns that are considered to be cool towns, they're doing things, you know, I think Bristol Borough can be very appealing to senior citizens, because people looking to downsize can come here and find some smaller houses. They can walk to a lot of things. But you know what? It also should be appealing to younger crowds. And younger crowds want things like dog parks and biking trails and bicycle racks and things like that. And we need to look into those things. And we're making that recommendation. It'll also alleviate parking. I think, again, without this pillar, the rest of the plan isn't going to happen. We are blessed with numerous service groups and volunteers. Historic Bristol Day doesn't happen by accident. A Taste of Two Cities doesn't happen by accident. Fireworks, the doo-wop concert, all those things are done by volunteers working very hard. However, at times their activities conflict or their efforts are duplicated. That idea again about working smart rather than working hard. And also, residents who wish to become involved often lack a clear avenue through which to volunteer. So we'd like to change that. We would like to do some things, suggest some things. First, and we've already done this, and we want to put another advertisement for it out tonight, we want to post a volunteer recruitment form on the borough website. It's there already. We want to encourage people to go to the borough website, download the form, fill it out, and either email it to us or hard mail it to us, and we're going to give you something to do. We also have posted the same volunteer recruitment form on the Raising the Bar Facebook page. You can do the same thing. Download, fill it out. We also created an email address. Julie Bowser is managing it for us. It's called raisingthebarbristol@gmail.com. For people that don't use Facebook, all we ask they do is send us an email at that address, raisingthebarbristol@gmail.com. Once they do, we'll put them in our database. And also that'll give them the opportunity to send us an idea if they'd like to, but we'll put them in our database, we'll mail them a volunteer form, and then when we're doing mass mailings, we can reach them in a quick and economical way. Okay? So that's important. Next, and we think this is very important, we want to develop a community electronic calendar to post group activities and plan for the use of facilities. There was a gentleman a while back, I think he lived in Landreth Manor, but he really loved Bristol. He passed away, and I'm sorry I don't remember his name, maybe somebody in the audience does. But he did a community calendar, but it was a hard copy calendar, and it was a tremendous amount of work. It was doomed not to be able to sustain itself because of the work involved. People would have to give him stuff. He would then have to type it, have it printed, and have it distributed, and then collect the old calendars. It was difficult. What we're talking about in the year 2013 is an electronic calendar. I think Google provides a platform where you can do that, where we would have two or three people in charge of managing the calendar, and every group in town could funnel their information electronically to that central location. It can be applied to the calendar, and any citizen can just, with the click of a mouse button, see what's going on, what's coming up next, what's coming up for the month. Okay, we won't be able to accommodate the bake sale for the church. There's nothing that small, but big things that everyone in town should know. By the way, Friday night we're having the Landmark Towns is having the Lagoon Canal Festival, and that's why all the ducks have been on the table for so long. And that kind of thing would be advertised on this calendar. We think it's important. Finally, the school district. The school district is not our committee's responsibility, but we thought we'd be remiss if we didn't mention what it says right there. Nothing impacts the economic viability of a municipality more than the quality and affordability of its school system. A town-wide survey that we administered a couple of months ago confirmed this assertion. People, you know, when you talk to a realtor, when someone's thinking about moving into town, or when someone's thinking about moving out of town, the thing they want to know about, especially moving into town, is what is the quality of the school system and what are the taxes? And so what we recommend is that the school district embark on a comprehensive analysis of factors influencing achievement levels, course and program offerings, tax rates, and declining enrollment. We need to take a motion out of this topic. We need to take a dispassionate look at what are we doing in school, how can we best serve our kids, and how can we best serve our taxpayers. And again, so what we're doing is inviting the school district, which I'm sure they will anyway, to do that. But it is vitally important to economic development, and we would have been remiss had we not mentioned it. Okay. Going forward, our operational structure, we've worked very hard. We think we've done a good job, and we ask you to support the continued work of this committee as listed there for the next 3 years. Okay? And then you can fire us all, or you can give us a parade, as the case may be. We'd like to continue and expand the Raising the Bar marketing efforts and the early action items that have enjoyed such success. We've got 400 people in Raising the Bar, another 400 like the page, one's a group, one's a page. People are enthused, and it's a good way to share information. We want to continue to do that. Now, this is going to cost a little money, but you know what? Sometimes things just need to be said. We really believe, and we're not trying to put anyone on a spot, but we really believe that we need to hire a part-time code enforcement officer. In spite of the heroic efforts of the elected officials and the manager and the staff, and some of our staff members go out in the car to issue citations or at least to do some code enforcement. But we think that we were better off when we had one before, and we think we can do a better job if we have one again. There's just too much out there that it's too hard to keep up with without one. So that's our recommendation. This one, now for that one, we don't have any money for you, but for this one, we think we can benefit from the appointment of a Main Street / housing manager, and we need to explore a combination of funding sources, okay? Main Street managers, the data shows very clearly that if you want to be successful in trying to revitalize your Main Street, you need someone who's going to carry that ball every day. We don't think we can afford that. We don't think you can afford that. It's a shame because we don't think we can afford not to, but the fact is that the money's not there for a full-time salary. But we do think that a part-time person can be very beneficial, a person that would have his or her hand on the pulse of the street, who would be doing follow-ups, who would be doing the positive things, the marketing, the joint marketing, and all of that. So we recommend that. In some other municipalities, the business district actually contributes toward the salary of that person. In others, they get a grant, and in others, the municipality kicks in. Let's just keep an open mind and talk about how we can possibly find some funds to let a Main Street manager carry the ball there a little bit. The last thing is the Discover Us video, which was released over a year ago with a very nice reception. Its purpose was twofold at the time. One was to just lift the spirits of the people who live in Bristol by reminding them what a beautiful community we have, and we did that. The other was to have a tool that we can mail out to potential people that wanted to invest in Bristol. Mark Swift just wrote a sample letter. As we said to the council before, when they said, well, why aren't we sending out the DVD? It's because if you just get a cold DVD, it's not going to have the impact we want it to have. We want to send a DVD out in response to inquiries from investors. We also want to send a DVD out when we want to poke a potential investor. It would be accompanied by a letter, a personalized letter, and it would be used as a marketing tool to go get some people to come here and invest in Bristol Borough. One more thing that's not on the slide, and that is we need to have an economic ambassadorship. When a potential investor comes to town, he or she ought to feel as though they are the most important person in town. They ought to be greeted by different people, by people from the business community. They ought to be wined and dined and walked through our historic districts and shown our assets and our rivers. They ought to be given cold, hard data about the cost of square footage for rental properties, what's available to them. All that stuff ought to happen so that they leave here saying that community has its act together. We think if we can do that, we can increase the likelihood that people will invest. And that, I'm sure you're happy to hear, is the end of the presentation. Thank you very much. Now, that was a lot to absorb, and what we'd like to do now is allocate time first for dialogue between council and committee members. If council person has a question or an observation, if I can refer to a committee member to help shed some light on it, I will.
Start with council.
And also, I have booklets. Let me give you the booklets now.
The elected officials first, and we have the official family. I'll give our committee later. As you'll see, what you're seeing here is the 10 pillars that I identified, the action plans that I identified, but as I said, there are 61 action steps. I went over 20, mercifully. But there are 61 there, and now the ones that I didn't go over are not earth-shattering, but we think they're important. They're narrow in focus, the kind of thing we think we can hand to a resident who wants to get involved and say, you know, go for this. And at the back in the addendum are several documents that we think really enhance the booklet and worthy of your attention.
Bill.
With that, why don't we have observations, questions, whatever. Lorraine?
Will the borough residents be able to see this report online, or how will we?
Very good question. Actually, the Bucks County Planning Commission put this on disk for us.
Okay.
So we'll talk to Matt. And with your approval and with Matt's ability, we will post this online once it is in the form that you guys want it to be in, and every resident in Bristol Borough will be able to access it. And of course, anyone who has access to the internet, so developers as well.
That's great.
Thank you.
I'm going to just touch on a few points.
Sure, sure.
I didn't have a pen in the beginning, so I don't know what. Touching on rental properties first, you know that's been a thorn in my side for 12 years.
Yep.
I mean, that's why I got involved there. But when you're dealing with 1,600 rental units, it's an uphill battle every day.
Yep.
I think that when we were doing the annual inspections, I think we had a better handle on it. We end up going to every 2 years because it was costing, you know, we had a lot of complaints where people were upset that it was costing $100 a year.
Right.
I always felt that was the price of doing business. If you want to be in the rental business, $100 a year means nothing when you're charging people, you know, a ton of money to rent your property. But a lot of absentee landlords don't care because they don't live in this town. They have no stake in this town. And that's always been an argument of mine. So I think we need to revisit that with council, excuse me, and maybe consider some kind of an awards program where if your property is maintained all the time, you don't have to do it as often. But we still kept in place, if you move out after 90 days, you still need to get it inspected. So that's one issue I agree
with. And that's one of the things we discussed, and I agree with you, that every time there's a transfer, of course, it should be inspected. And some, quote, good landlords are saying, we're getting penalized for the ones that you really want to look at. So, I think something along the middle where you get exempt if you have a good track record, and you get fast-tracked if you have citations, you know, however you can work that out. Yeah.
The Mill Street issue, I wish you a lot of luck with that. We met with all the property owners several years ago. And council's main concern was the properties from somebody visiting your town on one of the events or coming through town for whatever. You look in the windows, you see sheetrock, you see insulation. And we asked them, why don't you just do your window? Put some lights in a window, a couple pictures of something, put a curtain behind it, make it look presentable so when people are coming through town, the street looks good. We were unsuccessful in trying to do that, but we even took it a step further and said, if you can't do that, maybe just sweep your sidewalk once a week and put it in the street when the street sweeper's coming. So I think a lot of it starts with the people that own property on Mill Street. I know years ago, when we were kids, Mill Street was immaculate because the people that owned them stores lived upstairs, took care of their properties, and took pride in what they did. We lost that communication somewhere. And hopefully, maybe this is something that, you know, could come back and dealing with maybe a new organization can help. But I agree, if they can't comply, we have to start cracking down on them and let the chips fall where they fall.
Listen, it's been a long struggle, as we all know. I was on council 30 years ago, and we put in the brick sidewalks, we put in the antique lighting, we put in trees. It was going to stimulate things, and it takes pride of property owners. But I will say that there are, you know, some young property owners or these young renters who want to do a good job. And what I've heard a lot of is this could help them because some of them are afraid of their landlords. Some of them are afraid that if they complain about substandard conditions, they'll get evicted, and somebody will put somebody else in. So we may be doing them a favor as well. But the bottom line is, it's just unacceptable. It's just the town is frustrated by it.
I mean, you have people like, look at Design Works. They came in town 7-8 years ago, made a major investment. They end up moving in town. They live here. Birds of Paradise, Jimmy's here, so I mean, came in town, made an investment in this town, is... You know, his flower shop is now like the talk of the town. Joe's mom came in town, her clothing store. We do have people that want to invest, but it's a newer way of doing things. And that's what I think the problem is. You got the one regime that is happy with what they're doing, and then you got somebody else that wants to take it to a new level. And that's been the problem throughout town. You know, don't ruffle my feathers. I'm happy doing what I want to do. So I agree with that.
I think people complain about this. We need to ask them, what are you opposed to? Are you opposed to a facelift? Are you opposed to clean streets? Are you opposed to landlords that are responsible? What part are you opposed to? We just have to do this.
You talked about bringing property values up with homeowners, some kind of a package where incentives for people that own their homes. And like you said, because I fix up my home brings up somebody else's property value.
Right.
Again, it all starts with taking pride in what you're doing. You talked about planting trees. We have that list. The problem is we can't keep up anymore. People are cutting trees down. They're putting bushes where a tree used to be. So now you can't open car doors. It's 3 foot high. Again, that second inspector took care of a lot of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The tax credits, I agree. If there's a way to do an alert in certain areas or something like that to help people. The permit process, I think that works here. Again, we're always looking to improve anything we could improve. I think people need what you talked about, signage. I agree, but also people with these yard signs every week. You know, they're selling a house by owner, and they go staple up telephone poles with yard, and then they leave them up. Nobody goes and takes them down.
Move-in sale.
That's move-in. That's another problem, but again, our borough workers are taking signs down constant. We should go to that address, say you had a yard sale last week, you didn't take the sign down, and we cite them for it. Now, there's something that you talked about that may work. We have a welcome package that we send out to every new property owner, and we never discussed this. When they come in, they get a welcome package from the borough. Maybe now we expand on that with some of the stuff you're talking about to put into this welcome package, thank them, you know, coming into town, and
That's a good point. See, there's only so many hours in a day, so I think several times tonight I said, this is our perception, and it may well be that you guys are doing some of these things very well right now.
But
so you'd be able to have a dialogue
like
about it.
Days the trash is picked up and different things like that, but maybe we could expand on what we have. Add your stuff, and the borough secretaries could do it.
Mm-hmm.
Draft up a welcome letter from Raising the Bar about different things, and
good.
I think that would work. And I agree with the calendar. I think a lot of people want to know what's going on in town.
Definitely.
So that's just some of my input.
Thank you.
Greg?
Thank you.
I have a few questions. This might sound odd, but I swear this is not an act in the sense of we haven't had dinner together in a long time to discuss these things. I really have not had an opportunity to review this with my father.
Why I had more money in my wallet this morning? We haven't had dinner together for a while.
question for you as, or a few questions for you as well as pretty much everyone on the committee. I'm wondering if when you guys had conversations, you discussed what I think is an issue, and I'm coming from the perspective of someone that represents Farragut Avenue and completely agrees that Mill Street should be the focal point. I feel like we have a few oddly zoned, districted business areas, and Farragut Avenue is what pops out of, you know, out to me most obviously. You know, if you drive down Farragut Avenue, obviously you see a garage, you see a restaurant, you see a garage, you see a restaurant, you see a Wawa, you see a house. And it just seems like it's, and it's just an example, and I think there's other examples of that. Beaver Street, I think, has similar issues. Was there any conversation or discussion about being creative with those types of districts? Obviously, it's long-term. Maybe even, like, you know, Farragut Avenue, again, something that came to my mind when we're seeing what's happening on Route 13. They're trying to slow traffic, which isn't a bad thing, but they're also trying to, I think, soften the look of Route 13. Are there grants available and what you guys came across for things like that?
Well, the first part of what you mentioned, and the solicitor could address it better than I, is that what you talk about when you look at Farragut Avenue is a history of the United States before zoning. Most of those things are grandfathered in. They popped up here and there. And you're trying to play catch-up in dealing with an existing situation that is legally able to be there. We did not talk about the idea of aesthetically softening the street, but I suppose we could pursue it. Your comprehensive plan and your zoning map indicates, you know, recognizes the reality of what's there already, and you know, the challenge is to decide what to do from there. It's not an aesthetically appealing place, although I think some nice things are happening on Farragut Avenue, but still it's...
Yeah, I agree. And it's not just that it's not aesthetically pleasing. It's also...
Different.
It's difficult for the residents who live on one side of the street to deal with the businesses that are, especially the types of businesses, loud machinery, mechanics, restaurants, bars, whatever it might be. I'm just wondering if somewhere in a plan we can come up with some ideas. Maybe some, I mean, of course, I'm not saying good luck. You know, I would like to be part of it, but some ideas for, you know, softening streets, not just Farragut Avenue, places like Beaver Street and areas like that. Another thought that I had in listening to you, what you guys were presenting is seemed to be a lot of discussion about incentives for homeowners. And I think another unique and could be an asset to the borough, because there aren't many of these places left, are the number of row homes that we have. And I'm wondering whether it be Harriman, whether it be Jefferson Avenue, if perhaps we could come up with an idea about not just incentivizing one homeowner, but maybe a block of homeowners to cooperate with each other. And what I mean by that is, again, catching up with the times. If you look at Harriman, as my example, neighbors trying to improve throughout the years have changed their facade compared to their neighbors, yet there are a few houses that do cooperate. And in my opinion, and it's just an aesthetic thing, those four houses that communicate with one another, they just look far and away better than the houses that have, you know, just kind of different things in there.
I think when you look at the plan I just handed you that has the other 40 action items, one of the things we talk about is neighborhood groups. Just organizing neighborhoods, encouraging individual citizens to organize their neighbors to do things like that, to talk about joint cleanups and painting and things like that. And that conversation could lend itself to, and if we provide design assistance, we need to show people in Harriman what a quad of those homes used to look like and what they can look like. With you know, with not any additional cost, just making choices about facades that make sense to the historic and the architectural integrity of the area.
And so, I think that's a great recommendation. I also would like to see maybe if we're going to take on some ideas of actually incentivizing property owners, I think it would be a great incentive to say to four people that live in a row, if you guys cooperate with one another and here are some design ideas, some design plans, and you come to us as a group and say, this is what we would like to do, and we're going to do it together. I think that cooperative element of the whole thing would be great, especially in a town that we live in where we are so very close to one another, literally, as far as where we live.
We should recognize a property owner once a month up here. Somebody does a good job with a property and does the kinds of things we're talking about. Bring them up here and just take a minute to recognize them, because a lot of this has to be modeling, a lot of it has to be peer pressure, a lot of it has to be just people deciding they're going to do something different. Government can't do it all.
We were doing that in the past. When Josephine took that shop over, I know everybody has to remember it was a garage, an old garage, and she turned it around into a beautiful salon. And it is what it is today. We brought her here and welcomed her because, one, she was a minority in this town that did something with a great property. And because we wanted to show her that we appreciated the facade that she had there. And that's the kind of stuff we have been doing.
Let's do them systematically.
I just have two more things. One thing we did have the opportunity to speak about, and considering that I don't think you even remember totally, so maybe it flew below the radar of a lot of people, and I would just ask that we look at this. And that is when you're recommending a half a time code enforcement officer. That is something we actually dealt with about a year ago now, right? Where we kind of we wrestled with that proposal, and then what we decided on at the time being was we weren't happy with our current situation with our inspectors, and they were replaced. So I know there is this long-standing belief out there that our inspections have not been so great. I'm just wondering if we can maybe look at the point where we made that change and see if it has improved. If we're talking about things that are 2 weeks old or 2 months old, then there's a problem. I'm just wondering if we do know or if we have any anecdotal information that would tell us or factual information that would tell us, you know, when you made this change, since you've made this change, people are really still feeling up against it when they're trying to
and
do.
I'd like to clarify something because it's not our in-house people we're speaking of.
Right. And that may be the case. It may be that since you had that meeting and since you voiced your displeasure as a council, that maybe things have turned around. That's why we're talking about just have a dialogue. Just look at that punch list. Look at how you get from point A to point Z in the permitting process and see if we're satisfied with how it goes.
And then my last thing is just a recommendation, and that is about the video. Do you guys have it on YouTube?
If we do, I'm not aware of it.
Do we?
Shay says we do.
Okay, because obviously linking it to a YouTube, just if you're a business owner and you're getting a piece of mail and you have a video that's on DVD, some people don't even have DVD players anymore. And another maybe just idea would be, because it's a lengthy DVD that could go on for some time as far as someone that's actually interested in investing, maybe a trailer, like a 3-minute mini version that we could put up on YouTube that says, if you're actually interested in watching this video, here's what you might see.
Okay. So. I'm not sure, but I think Greg just told me I'm old. I'm not sure. I think you did.
The word was long-winded. Could have been. Just saying.
I really like the calendar idea, and I'd like to be a part of that. I wanted to be a part of that for a while. And maybe work here with what we have here, you know. Also, I would love to see a part-time code enforcement officer because I think we need to be proactive. I know Greg and I ride around and look at properties. Betty looks at properties in her area. We all do it. And, you know, it's hard for us to do that, although we don't mind doing it, but I think we really need somebody, an extra person, because it's really hard for one person to handle all of that, you know. So I think we should really look into hiring someone. And that's basically it.
Patty?
I just think that a lot of it has to do with communication. It's just not council. Like she says, we do ride around and we do try to report in our areas because sometimes people say we're not doing what we're supposed to be. But I think the community itself, like if I live next to somebody and they're not putting out their trash the way they're supposed to or whatever, it's up to the community to, you know, reach out to us, to Mr. Dillon, who's always on top of all these problems when we have them. Probably, you know, we need to look into having a part-time zoning officer or inspections or whatever. But also, I think the best advocate for Mill Street is Robin, who's there every single day, but she walks her dogs down there, and she checks things out, and she'll call me, and we stay in touch with each other. And Mill Street has been such a focus for us because, like, the couch house, one minute we were building, one minute we were redoing, then we weren't, and it's just up and down, up and down. We get excited because we think something big is coming into town, and then it doesn't happen. And, you know, people come to Mill Street, and they start out, and if it's not working for them or it's not going fast enough, they disappear or they close down. It's hard to keep these people there. But, you know, It's, we have ordinances, we do try to stay on top of it, and that's the best we can do. We don't want to sit there and, you know, bang them too much, because we don't want them all to run away. And they are, like, some people are afraid of their landlords. Some people are afraid that if they do, you know, complain, they'll be out. But I think communication's the main thing, making sure people understand that they can call, they can complain, it could be private, it could be, you know, that way. And, like, every year we have that, we offer the free permits to clean up and improve your, you know, residence. Everybody in town should jump on that, you know? That's the time when you want to get a dumpster and clean out the backyard and replace your fence. I mean, you have the perfect opportunity there. We're not trying to make money off of people fixing their properties. We're trying to make it look nicer, because this is the future of our kids, and we want them to stay here. The school's another issue for me, because, like, I have a grandson, and I want to make sure that, you know, I don't want to see them move, because we don't have the schools that we need because of what's going on in town. So that's a big thing. I think this is a great development plan. I think you guys have done a wonderful thing, and I look forward to seeing all of this go into place. You have my support completely.
Thank you, Betty. And I want to reiterate, we know what you and Robin do on that street on a daily basis. It's too big.
Yeah.
It's too much. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about a partnership between private citizens and government to try to move it forward. And one of the things we didn't mention, I visited a couple businesses that opened recently and already closed. And I'm not a business person, but when I walked in and I looked and I thought to myself, it's not going to happen. Yeah. And it didn't. We can provide, we have businessmen in town who are willing to sit down with people wanting to start a business, to give them some support, to give them some advice, to point them in the right direction in some areas, to ask them the key questions. And I think that can help.
Yeah.
There's a whole lot.
As residents, we need to take the opportunity, the time to walk down Mill Street, check it out. It, you know, it's getting better. It's been better. And like Jimmy's store, I walked in there, I was like, wow, this is beautiful.
Yep. He's done a tremendous job.
Give them that little bit so they can see.
Keep
it
local.
And we can see that. It's there. It's nice. Yep. We can do this.
Keep it local.
Maybe also in the welcome package, we could put contact numbers of people that have been in business for a while and that could mentor, you know. That would be a great idea.
When I was first elected 12 years ago, I made Mill Street my baby, and it still is today. Like Betty said, I walk. You can set your clocks by me at 7 o'clock. Ben and Jerry and I are walking on leashes down Mill Street. A couple of issues. Number one, surprisingly enough, Stocks Restaurant, for the bad condition that it's in, I've been trying for 2 years to get it blighted. One of the ways that you get it blighted is it has to have all these citations against it, and there's no citations against it. So surprisingly, you would be surprised at how bad the condition of a business has to get to be before you're able to really do something about it. I was shocked. Went to John Miller, I said, you know, I show me all the citations against Stocks, I'm going to take this to the board, and there weren't any. So that's I think, one of the issues. And I'm going to say, even though it's not going to be very popular with some people, that I don't think you'd call it a business, in the theater district that goes from Radcliffe Street to Cedar Street, I don't even know what it is. It's a brick building. And the windows have been boarded up, and for as long as I've lived in Bristol, that building has stayed that way. Yep. So before I start to pound away at the people, which I'll get to, on Mill Street, something has to be done about that building.
Right.
And we all pass it up as if we're, you know, it's that no talk rule in an alcoholic family. Like, oh, we know Dad's drunk again. But that building's a disgrace, and it's, again, you go there on a Friday night, and the Couch House is booming, and the King George is booming, and the theater people, and Bobby's got me, and that property sits that way, and it drives me crazy.
And you know what, Robin? It's a beautiful building. It could be something really nice, or it could be removed, one or the other.
I brought it up the other day at an Enterprise Zone meeting.
Yeah.
The problem is unreasonable owners. You know, we had an hour meeting with Bob White at the Enterprise Zone, and he went on to talk about, he actually drove through Bristol, and he found all these other properties that Greg and I hadn't identified. And I said, you think we don't know what they are? We know what they are. But you've got people that just don't care. And they're property owners, like that building on, and like stocks. So I don't know how you address that, guys. I really don't. As far as Mill Street goes, it really has gotten better. Mm-hmm. We attracted, thank God, for Nicky Marino, who started, which was the best thing he could have done, his little kiosk thing. So out of that came Joe Marie's. On Mill Street, we attracted Jimmy. Mm-hmm. We attracted the new store that came. It's getting better. The biggest issue, and I don't know whether we get, I had thought at one point about having perhaps, and I hate to use the term, block captains. They have to clean up their streets.
Definitely.
And I'm saying it. I mean, if people don't like it, you know, email me. Dr. Berg's office, it's a physician's office. The cigarette butts on the, it is a disgrace. So you've got this nice, you know, brick sidewalk. And the business association has improved. I went in there about a month ago in a tie road. Jimmy will attest to it. I went in there. And bottom line is I had a very good talk with the gentleman who's now the president, and they really do want to work with us. And I've promised them that I'll be the liaison. I'm going to go to their luncheon. I will speak. I will support whatever you need from this council. We are willing to do in order to keep you know, Mill Street going. A few years ago when Donna Boone was here for Landmark Town, she did this great thing and said, we should clean up Mill Street. My theory is always, if I was a councilman and my ward was, let's just say, Buckley Street, I would get a broom and I would get a trash can and I would say to my other councilman, let's go sweep the street. And I always thought that you could kind of inspire other people. Then people would come out and say, it's a great idea, let's all help to clean the street. So Donna Boone had a program, and we were all going to go out and clean up. And you know who came out that day? And do you know the business owners from Mill Street came out and watched us? And it was me and my poor Michael and Tony Ivy and Megan Ivy. And four residents came and we swept Mill Street while business owners
and they watched.
So I think that, well, first of all, what we have to do is you have to patronize Mill Street. You can't criticize and talk. You have to buy your flowers. You have to go to Mark Carter for your photographs. You have to shop at Mignoni's. I mean, seriously.
Don't forget Joe Marie. She's here.
These people are making, if each one of us spent $20 a month in Mill Street, business would be able to flourish and we would attract more. But I think one of the biggest things that we as a community have to do is impress upon these business owners the importance of how it looks. I have, everybody knows, 6 children. I lived from paycheck to paycheck my whole life, but their faces were clean and their sneakers were washed. And that first impression, the street, the streets have to be clean and the windows have to look good. Mm-hmm. So, and I think that you as a committee and we as a community have to impress upon these owners. Again, when Jimmy's store was closed that day, I went in and read him the riot act and said, your store can't be closed during the day. You have to find somebody to deliver your flowers. And I think if each of us as citizens would take the responsibility, and it's not popular to walk in and tell somebody what they're doing wrong, but you know why? It's okay to step up. And it's okay to put it out there and if people don't like it. Okay.
I'm so happy to hear that because that's exactly what we have to do. We have to step up.
Right.
We have to have the courage to lead. We have to have the courage to be facing some opposition and say, you know what, we're trying to do something good.
And we're doing it for the good of all of us.
Right. And we can do it with a carrot. You know, and I think a lot of those people, maybe tapping them again, I would have hoped that someone else would have grabbed the broom that day when they watched you. But we can't give up. We just have to give it a new, re-energized shot.
I just may need to borrow some carrots from you. That's all, Mr.
well, I'm sorry, Ralph. Go ahead.
Three quick things. I was going to see, I'd like to get some input from the people here, but just some train of thought is, one, if people would just call the borough, and when people are moving in and out on weekends, mm-hmm. rental units, just call the borough. You don't have to give your name if you don't want, and say so-and-so moved out of this address, or so-and-so we see people moving in. Because that's a major problem we have trying to catch people on, at nights and weekends. The other thing is, I announced this several times over the last, past several years, people say we don't have the money to fix up our home. Now, this is for property owners. Well, if you really and truly don't have the money, the redevelopment authority has money. It's interest-free. They'll loan you the money to do things on your home, and they put a lien against your property, and you don't pay it back until you sell your property. So you're getting money at interest-free for as long as you own your home. I mean, it's a no-brainer if you truly don't have the money. But a lot of people say, I don't have the money, but they just don't want to fix it. So if you don't have the money, your neighbor's complaining, oh, I would fix my porch, but there's money available, believe me, if people really need it. And the other problem we run into is fines. And I don't know if Robin just touched on this, but we cite landlords, take them to court, they pay a fine instead of fixing the property, and then they start all over again. So now it takes us another 6 months to get them back to court, and hopefully the fine's greater. But if you're paying a $100 fine or a $25 fine or a $300 fine, that's going to cost you $4,000 or $5,000 to fix your property. These people rather pay the fine. And that's the other issue we run into. And people say, why aren't they fixing this property? And we try to explain to them. It took us 5 months to get him in court. We finally got him into court. They pled guilty to all the citations. And under the law, they only could pay X amount of dollars per fine. It's not a borough law. It's a state law. You only could charge them so much. So they all know the system. And that's been another issue with the borough. But I don't know. We got so many people here tonight.
I'd like to give four people here just 30 seconds each.
Sure.
I'd like Joanna to just give us a capsule of the first-time home buyer incentives. Yeah, let me give you. Get your microphone.
Thank you. As you know, our committee is really committed to home ownership, and I think that's what we're looking for. And part of not only my bank, but all of the banks in the community, we have what's called a community redevelopment plan. There's community home loans available for home ownership for the low to moderate income tracts, and Bristol Borough falls into that tract. And a lot of the residents of Bristol Borough will fall into the financing piece and will qualify for this. There's the maximum home price is $160,000, and there's a lot of houses on the market right now that are $160,000 and under. That we could actually, we just don't put people in houses. We give them training. We give them home buyer education courses. We work with them, and if they qualify with the income, we lower some of the levels for restrictions on as far as credit and everything is concerned. So we work with them to build up their credit, get them into the houses. But then we don't want to see them fail. We work with them after that. We have grants, and we give them money to actually fix up that house if they want to buy carpets, if they want to put paint in the house. So this is a really good program. The maximum that somebody would actually spend to get into a house is $1,500. But in most cases, we actually take back a lot of the fees, and they don't. We'll do 100% financing. And this is part of the Community Redevelopment Act to help low to moderate income in the community. So it's a good program.
Thank you, Joanna. We have to publicize it better and try to facilitate its use.
We do.
Lynn, if you, as an outsider, although you've spent enough time here now, you're no longer an outsider. We're making an honorary citizen. I just wonder if you wanted to comment on that in a general sense.
In general, I think the committee's done a spectacular job. I'm happy to play a supporting role, and I know that as you move forward, if you can take advantage of some of those newly formed loan programs, I think you'll be in a good position to have your businesses take advantage of those. So it's a great job.
Thank you very much. Amy Kazar is the managing director of the Bristol Riverside Theater, and it attracts 42,000 ticket holders a year. I wonder if Amy would just like to share something about economic development and tourism and theaters and whatever.
Sure.
This one?
Sure. I'm not exactly sure what you're looking for, but I can tell you a little bit about our audience and the impact of our audience.
That'd be great.
Okay. So, as you said, the audience is about 42,000 ticket holders a year. And there are quite a few studies of the economic impact of those ticket buyers. And in the northeastern suburbs of Pennsylvania, of Philadelphia, ticket holders spend an average of $37 every time they see a show, in addition to their ticket. And that $37 is typically spent in local businesses. It's spent in local restaurants. It's spent going out for a drink after the show. So all of that money stays very local. And that comes out to about $1.5 million a year for the businesses most local to BRT. That is in addition to the impact of the company itself. So that's excluding the money that we spend locally, building sets, hanging lights, paying people, all of those things. In addition to that, our audience is generating $1.5 million. The theater supports, I believe it's 87 full-time equivalent jobs. And in addition, that is in addition to that, there are the jobs at restaurants and gas stations and salons and everything else that are supported by the clients. So it's a pretty it's a massive number, really, from that theater that goes into the local businesses, which I think is part of this idea of creating a theater district, even though we only have one theater, is about how you. How you amplify that impact to more businesses and in such a way that it, even more of that $37 stays local, to encourage people to spend it in Bristol when they come here.
And I think it's a very important message for, because most borough residents don't use the theater. And so if they don't use the theater and they don't use the museum, they don't belong to the Artists of Bristol, whatever, they might be thinking, well, what's this have to do with me? It has a lot to do with economic development for the town. So thank you for sharing that.
And let me just add that I have to tell you that you will have to go very far to see the kind of productions. Inherit the Wind was amazing. I met with somebody today who was going to do something, who's volunteered to do something unrelated, and her son was in Inherit the Wind. And if you don't, if you have, what is the cost, Amy, for a yearly subscription to the theater?
It ranges from $100 to about $150 for five shows.
So, I mean, for five shows, $150 is not a lot of money, and I promise you, I've never been to the theater that I haven't seen a top-rated show. And, like, one of the few communities that have that. And the other thing, just quickly, is I think it's just so amazing that we have all these people who showed up tonight and we have this common goal. So I thank you, Bill, but I also think we have to keep it going. We can't sit here tonight and say, oh, this is a great meeting and a great idea, and then if we have to keep this thing moving, or you've wasted your time and we've wasted our time, and that would be a shame. So I'm sorry.
Thank you, Rob.
Thank you.
Mark Swift in the corner. Asked not to speak tonight, so we're going to hand him the microphone now. Mark really did yeoman's work behind the scenes with so much of what you have in the document in front of you. And Mark, I just wonder if you want to comment on either historic preservation or economic incentives or the merger of the two, whatever you're comfortable with.
I have very little wind, but I'll give it a shot. And really what I want to do is just go over the incentives quickly. I think when you read the plan, you'll see that we have five incentives in it. And those incentives are a result of hundreds of hours of discussions that I have had with people from Canada, looking at the bids in Canada, right on through every developer that I know, literally on the East Coast. And the first one is a group of incentives that Joanna just discussed, and it's all about first-time home buyers. And out of the box, we only named a few, and I think you'll find that I named the First Step incentive, which is great, from NLH in Pittsburgh, as well as to what Joanna has in her banks, as well as a whole lot that I didn't discuss. There's a ton of incentives available for first-time home buyers from the electric company, from the various utility groups, and they're everywhere. when you looked at the recommendations on the last page, you get a sense that we need someone to help people wade through that. So when we get an opportunity, or a realtor gets an opportunity, we need to leap upon that person, and we need to help him through all of the various incentives. You can't really do a CAN program. You really need to do it with a view of looking people in the eye and helping them through it and stay with it until A, they understand it, and B, they get all the applications filled out correctly. So that alone for a first step is huge, and it's a necessary requirement. The second incentive, which is really modeled on Quakertown, is this deferral of assessment on new improvements to your house. And it is biased towards our very patient residents and homeowners in Bristol Borough. They really have nothing. Even if they live in the historic district, which I'll go over quickly, they have nothing. So this is an incentive for them to be able to improve their properties, defer the assessment for a period of years, and you could make that any period that you wish, and you then you could start to see people will maybe take the advice of an incentive in the book, where we'd like to have the carpenters of town get together and do some help in terms of helping people with how to build things, how to do things themselves, how to do it right, and then obviously use the tax deferral incentive, which has no effect on anyone, as long as the three taxing authorities agree. And the first one, obviously, is the school district, the second is the borough, and the third is the county, which I have from good sources that that's not a slam dunk, but I think we could argue our point, and I think the council certainly would be able to make that happen. So that's something we need to act upon, and we need to act upon that soon, because we need to attract and help the people who live here who have been valiant supporters of the town, who are getting damn tired of looking at all these incentives that go to everybody else and not to them. The third incentive, and the best one that we have available to us, is the federal tax incentive credit for historic building rehabilitation. But unfortunately, it's only available to income-producing properties. So at the end of the day, no one uses it wisely, and you have to be a contributing structure in the district. So the low-rise industrials that Robin mentioned, really, we would have difficulty years ago in getting an incentive credit for them to restore those buildings and get the 20% credit. I spent a long time with the regional director of PHMC responsible for this area, and he tells me that there are creative ways that we can do things now that we couldn't then. He also informed me that there is a 10% tax incentive credit available to buildings that were built prior to 1926. And we talked in length about Farragut Avenue and the buildings in Farragut Avenue, how to improve the facades and what might be available to them. And clearly, what kind of tools we can give the art when someone comes and says, I don't have the money for an income-producing apartment building on Wood Street, they would start to say, well, wait just a minute. Did you apply for the tax incentive credit? It's worth 20%. You'll be afforded some architectural advice in the process. You fill out part one, and you get them now engaged in the community, which is a tool, frankly, no one has used in the past. And we really need to use it now. And then there is an incentive yet to be developed to effectively use the federal historic rehab credit, but you have to be arm's length and you have to be an income producing activity, which is to say there is a good possibility that some of the buildings on the block that somebody asked about, and they all want to do their properties and they want to restore a block of properties either on in where there is a historic district. They would have to take these properties and basically sell them to a syndicate. The syndicate at that point would buy the properties and keep the people in their homes for a token rent. Those owners would at that point become non-owners and they'd have to pay the taxes. It would have to be arm's length and the waiting period is 5 years. And I only know of one place where it has been done, and it's been done in Seattle, Washington, and it was very successful. In an area that is potentially as difficult as some of the areas that we have on cedar wood, all around town. You know, the most beautiful part of town is how you come in to the houses and the porches along Otter Street. I mean, it's a spectacular street. Imagine what you could do with that if you restored 3 or 4 blocks of those houses, what that would look like with some antique lighting and in turn turn those neighborhoods back into, and they're not even in the historic district, but they all would qualify for the 10%.
And could that syndicate be the one that that you guys recommend or you hope to resist?
We are keen to start using some of this wonderful 40,000 visitors, and they're not 40,000 visitors, but they represent 40,000 tickets. I mean, imagine if we go out and we say, now we have developed a theater district, and we have a block, and we want somebody to take a look at this. Somebody that we may know, somebody that we don't know. But we start kicking around the actual spending potential that 40,000 tickets has. And we start talking about low-rise industrials that could be gone because they are not contributing buildings in the area. I mean, the developer would come in who would want to do the whole area, not just 2 or 3 buildings. Right now, there are probably 10 of those buildings are for sale in that block. And the rest of them could be had to the right people for the right reasons. With, in fact, the view of the borough's forward-looking plans of having rebuilt its infrastructure as well as what it has planned in the future. And there's what we need to be working at. We need to
wine and dining those people.
Well,
those are the people
you think about how it all works. You convince somebody from in that you know, and you bring them to the borough hall to meet borough employees. Everybody has to have a record. You know, you got to knock it out of the ballpark. From there, you go meet the business district. And you want representatives from all the business districts. You want somebody in retail. You want somebody from big business in town. People who have the town have interest in that their heart. And then from there, you go and you meet the code officers and you start talking about, before you ever get them to invest their due diligence, all the people I know, they wouldn't put 2 cents in due diligence until you pass the smell test. And you have to pass it and you have to have laws and it's got to look right. And you can't have people sleeping on park benches and all of the activity that is in that plan that ties it all together. And of course, the fifth incentive is trying to give someone incentive which is not revenue neutral now. Now we've got to dig in our pockets to be able to take a multi-flat and convert it back into a single house. It's not easy to do, and I can tell you, I've done it twice. It's not an easy deal. It's a big deal. By the way, we wonder what we're going to do with that big monster now. But having said that, when you look at it, don't think that they're the only incentives that we looked at. We looked at hundreds of them. We just wanted to come out of the box with everybody accounted for. First time, business people, developers, residents, and people who might want to do a big project are kind of afraid and need a push.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Mark.
Before we turn it over to the audience, and I'm including other committee members, they didn't get a chance to speak if they want to at that time. Obviously, we have our work cut out for us, and there are so many narrow focus projects that one of you could embrace and want to run with. And we have volunteer forms with us tonight. I'd like you to encourage you to take one with you, or better yet, fill it out before you leave. And all we're trying to do is match your interests, your skills, and your time availability with a task that we'll envision. Just tell us what you like to do. We'll find the task and give you a call and try to get us together, okay? But if not, as Robin said, it's going to be a very nice night. It's not going to amount to anything. I've been part of so many plans in the education world and in the municipal world. You write the plan, you put it on the shelf, and that's the end of it. This can't happen, and it's not going to happen unless you get involved and people like you. So.
Well, I know if there's any track record, we don't put anything on the shelf and let it last.
Yep.
All right, let's start on this side of the room. If anybody would like to say anything or speak on anything, go to the podium, and Bill's up front could answer at any one of their committees, so. Anybody on this side of the room would like to speak? Want to state your name and offer the record?
Eric Skowski. And I'd like a lot of your ideas for getting the businesses to do more and care more about the community. I liked your story where you said, yeah, I was got a couple residents to sweep the streets and the business owners were standing outside just not doing anything. Now, when you're running a business, one thing that gives you a lot of good incentive is this. Now, I've noticed something, that when there's a festival, that the business owners seem to care just a little bit more. They upkeep their shops, get it nice and pretty. They keep that extra hours so they can stay open longer, get more business for the whole festival. And I was actually approached by a bunch of people. I'm a motorcycle rider. There used to be a bike night here, and it has to be sponsored by a nonprofit. They lost the nonprofit, and there's no way for somebody to just say, I'm a motorcycle hobbyist. I want to have my event here without having a nonprofit sponsor it. There should be something on the borough website where it invites more people that are just hobby groups to have, hey, we're going to have a hockey tournament here. This is our, you know, we don't have a organized nonprofit. We're just a whole bunch of people that want to do this, and have people come in from out of the borough to spend their money in town, and it can help them, shop owners, stay open longer and earn that extra buck so they have that incentive to keep their businesses running better, you know?
Well, it costs the borough a lot of money to put an event on, number one. I like to really stay on the topics of what is in this Raising the Bar platform, but to get into bike night and all the borough, it just was, it outgrew us. We couldn't handle it anymore.
All right.
Anybody else on this side of the room?
Hi, Joe Saxton. I want to commend the committee for putting together an outstanding presentation. With the 10 pillars, I think the key thing that really stands out to me is the at least three of the principles that I think we've always keyed upon, which is the with your town continues to grow, and of course with economic development, is the fact that you look at your housing stock and the laws that apply to those, your downtown area and the laws that apply to those in your school district. I think Bill mentioned that. I think with what you've put together in plan, I think if we're able to focus on those items, I think we'll see a return and a continued improvement in the economic development. One of the things that I'd like to be involved in and also see as part of a real challenge is Pillar 9, where we talk about the volunteers. I think that's one of the real hits that we've taken over the last 30 years. Our volunteer base is really reduced. When you look at no matter what event we try to put on, it's that same group of 50 to 75 volunteers. I don't know within your plan if you're looking at focusing on building that group of volunteers, but I'd like to suggest to you that we look at as young as 15 and focus at, say, 15 to 50 in beginning an effort now to build that volunteer base, because I think the younger that we start in trying to get, you know, our kids interested in being involved within the community, you know, as they grow older, they'll participate, you know, at that younger age, and then they'll want to be involved in everything that we do. You know, we have so many different organizations in this town, and people participate. I mean, we know that people participate from what we do in this town. But again, it's that, I won't say small, because I think there's about 200 to 300 volunteers, but the volunteer base is growing very old, as we all know. So if there was something that we could do as part of this economic development group, as a focus to begin to, I don't want to say train, but mentor people, kids, volunteers in that, say, 15 to 50 age group, I think it would go a long way. And who do I give my form to?
Why don't you give it to Amy McElveen? She'll gather them tonight, okay? Thank you very much, Joe. And that's a great idea. And I hope everyone will take a form. Feel free to reproduce the form and just do some shoulder tapping. Give it out, young people, old people, whoever. And once we get that, and don't be afraid. It's not that, oh boy, I'm going to get sucked into something that I don't want to do. We will only ask you to give the amount of time that you're willing and able to give.
Okay. Anybody else on this side of the room would like to speak on anything? Anybody on this side of the room? Somebody. Anybody? There he goes.
All right, we keep. Jose Acevedo, North Ward. I wanted to touch base on what Robin's talking about, that building on Market and Wood Street. I lived on Market Street from 89 to 2006, and it's just a terrible, terrible building to look at like that.
Well, I don't mean it's on Radcliffe to Cedar.
Oh, you're talking about it different. I'm talking about the old Klein House.
Yes, is it? Well, no, not
that. That's the one I'm referring to. The old Klein House on Market and Wood.
Yes, okay. I'm very familiar with the Klein property.
Also boarded up. We fought them for a little while through the years, and we stopped going after them. And it's an out-of-town landlord. You know, we can't let them people dictate that it's okay to have a building like that. You have streets in Bristol that lead into town, and that's a very important street leading out of town. All the festivals that we have, that's hundreds and hundreds of cars during festivals come down that street. And to see that building boarded up like that, it's just not right. I think whoever...
Well, we're almost out of time. Let me just give you a quick synopsis, just so you know, that for 12 years that I've been here, I fought that particular building. I campaigned on it.
Right, I remember that.
The gentleman who owns it is an attorney.
He's deep pockets. I understand. Yeah, I remember all that.
He does, and we keep going back.
Right.
He's got nothing to lose, so we're close to a...
What's his interest in just holding on to that property? What, does he need to sell it? Can we buy it off of him?
He wanted what he wanted, and when he was denied it, he just kept appealing. But I don't want to go too much into it. We have till 9 o'clock, and then they're going to cut us off. So.
But I think it's an important property to take care of.
I agree with you. I feel foolish that it still looks as bad as it did.
Yeah, it's a shame. Yeah. And it's a beautiful building. I mean, the walls aren't probably 2 feet wide.
Right.
You know, so it's got to be really, really, really old. It has to be.
And Mark Smith told me that's River Rock. See, here, look at him. He's not.
Don't do it.
That's all I wanted to say.
Anybody else? Joe?
Yeah, Joe Nelson from Wilson Avenue. Just a couple things real quick. Number one, tonight is a success for me because I got hooked up with Mark Swift, who I went to grade school with, and I haven't seen since the eighth grade. So after 50 years, Mark and I hooked up again. You know, we were friends back then, and I would still consider him a friend today. There's a lot here that has to be digested and turned about. The building you're talking about, I think, used to be a car dealership at one time many, many years ago. Am I right? Yeah. And why it's gotten so bad, I don't know. But there's times that we have to look at maybe getting money off the Redevelopment Authority and actually using eminent domain to take some of these properties over, throw these people out of town. If they don't want to do something on their own, we may have to take the initiative to throw them out. Now, use eminent domain to acquire the property. We'll fight the purchase price in court. It's better than a 12-year battle because it would have been resolved a lot before this if we would have done that. So there's a lot of things to do. New businesses coming into Mill Street. The Lower Bucks Chamber of Commerce has an excellent program called the SCORES program, Service Corps of Retired Engineers, that can help these businesses establish a business plan, get them aimed in the right direction. It's a no-charge asset. We've got to look at this. We have the Rotary into town. We have a lot of service organizations that could help these people as well. So these volunteers have got to look at every aspect of it and establish a game plan. One of the things that always come back to me, people say, why don't we have a nonprofit that can go in, buy a house that's dilapidated, fix it all up, sell it, use the profits to fund the next house? So we would have to get a group of people to establish a nonprofit corporation to start doing this, but they are steps in the direction you want to go. Now is the time to do it with the boat docks coming in, because there's nothing to make you happier than every Saturday and Sunday those boat docks are filled up with people walking up and down Mill Street, going in and you know, participating with the vendors. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bobby, couple things just want to add before we leave. I'm sorry. Go ahead, Bob.
Do you have anything, Bob?
I just want to say, like, I want to thank the committee for putting this plan together. Excellent committee, excellent plan. I do a lot of traveling on the weekends as a motorcycle rider, and when people find out that I'm from Bristol, they say Bristol is the best kept secret in Bucks County. I think with this plan, we will no longer be the best kept secret. We will be the best in the county. I just want to thank Mr. President and the committee for what they have done.
And I want to say, this is a real tribute to this council to sit here tonight and listen to, because they work hard and have had such success and done a phenomenal job of bringing millions of dollars of grants into the town. And so to sit here and listen to us spout off about what we think we need to do next is a tribute to them and to their self-reliance, and it's a good thing. It's a good kind of a working relationship that we need to build on. And the second thing is fill out those volunteer forms. And third, I'll leave it up to the solicitor and the manager and the council president to decide where we go from here, but we would like you to do something in July. You know, I think if you adopt a plan, that doesn't mean you're agreeing to do everything that's in it. I think it means conceptually you're saying move forward, and as we come to you with things that need council approval that are in the plan, you'll approve them as they come forward.
I
think that we'll make this an agenda item for July to approve your concept plan. And before we do leave, I mean, I don't think people realize the knowledge that's in this room and the experience that you, Mark, you bring to the table. I mean, is beyond what anybody can comprehend with the companies you deal with and the time and effort you put into this. I know personally how busy you are, and I want to thank you, but hopefully we could build on this. And Joanna, with your knowledge, and Lynn from coming in, always supporting us from the county. So, I mean, it means a lot to this town and to this council. I think, you know, you may have your naysayers, but
and we have,
everybody knows what direction we're moving in.
And I think just last thing is that we're all in this together. So, thank you.
And there's people on the other side of that aisle who run corporations and who manage, have significant business responsibility and take the time to be on this committee. And you know, even because they're sitting back there, doesn't diminish their importance.
And I want to recognize, I don't know if they did, Gene Williams from the Grundy Foundation for being here this evening and spending the last few hours with us. And partnering up with the borough on other things means a lot to us. Thank you.
9 o'clock, we're right on schedule here.